93-94% on room air. Pulses and BP were still okay. So she decided to start low flow oxygen and call the pediatrician. So I have these four questions after every case. So first question is, do we think that this can be counted as a normal transition? Because, you know, there is some problem, but the baby is otherwise okay. Next question is, when to intervene? Should we just wait for some more time? Could that nurse have waited before starting low flow oxygen? Or was that the right decision? Again, what intervention should we do for such a baby? Should we give some CPAP rather than low flow? Or should we just let the baby transition because some amount of grunting can be normal after birth? And how do we anticipate and make a contingency plan so that, you know, what if this baby, you know, doesn't improve and gets sicker? So let us see what happened with this baby. So the baby was observed with low flow oxygen. At 6 hours, the pediatrician noticed that there was increased work of breathing. SpO2 was now 85% despite low flow. The baby looked very much off color and the grunt was persisting. So the baby was admitted and a blood gas was done. pH was 7.18 with PCO2 of 78. So there was respiratory acidosis. PaO2 was 45. Bicarb was 24. So there was respiratory acidosis. And this was the X-ray. So a low volume lung with some fissures that you can see on the right side by the arrow. Otherwise, the X-ray is pretty much unremarkable. So because of the grunting and the distress, the baby was started on CPAP with a PEEP of 6, FiO2 of 40%. Because the distress was there and off color was there, transiently IV fluids were started. Sepsis screen was done, which was negative. The baby was started on feeds by Ryle's tube on the second day. The baby came off CPAP on day 4 and discharged on day 12. So oral feeding again took some time. The baby was a late preterm baby. So basically, let us talk a little bit about the physiology, what happened. So the most important organ for transition that we know is the lung. So cortisol, thyroid hormones, and catecholamines, they shut down the active chloride-mediated secretion of the fetal lung fluid. So the fetal lung is essentially in the secretory state. There is constant secretion of fluid into the alveoli, into the air spaces, and it is actually fluid-filled because obviously inside the uterus, the baby is not breathing. And there is active transport of chloride ions from the interstitial space into the lumen. And then sodium and water actually flows passively. In the neonatal period, the epithelial sodium channels are activated, which is on the apical surface. I'll show a picture and I want everybody to just look at this picture slowly with me. So this side of the picture, which is the blue fluid-filled lung, that is the fetal side. And this side is the neonatal side. So the type 1 cell, which you can see here, that is a type 1 pneumocyte. It is typically very flat and elongated. The type 2 pneumocyte or the type 2 alveolar cell is cuboidal. It is short, so you can see, recognize it even without the label that this is a type 2 pneumocyte. On the type 2 cell, you can see, so this side will be the basolateral or the blood-loving surface of the cell. This side is the apical surface, which is towards the air interface. So these two surfaces are of the type 2 pneumocyte. So on this basolateral surface, on the side of the basolateral surface, there is interstitium and the capillary. So the gas exchange happens here. So the sodium potassium pump is on this basolateral surface. On the apical surface, you can see this chloride channel. So what happens is during the fetal life, the chloride channels are open and the chloride sort of goes. Chloride is obviously negatively charged. So to balance that, the sodium goes here. And with the sodium, the water follows. So that is how the fetal membrane or the fetal alveolus is a secretory membrane. It constantly secretes fluid into the alveoli. So the lung is filled with fluid. Post-delivery, what happens? Due to the glucocorticoids, thyroid, catecholamine, all these hormones, these epithelial channels are activated. These sodium channels are also called as amiloride-sensitive sodium channels. So once these sodium channels are activated, the sodium flows from this apical surface into the cell. And obviously with sodium, again, water follows. So whatever water was there actually gets reabsorbed. And then this sodium actually is thrown out by this sodium potassium pump on the basolateral surface of the type 2 pneumocyte. So this is the commonest principle or the recent principle for transient tachypnea of newborn. So activation of the sodium channels is very important. So in the sheep models, when they were baby sheep, infusion of cortisol and T3 actually activates the sodium pump, which normally should happen in term babies. But in late preterm babies who have had an elective C-section without going through the labor, So the labor pain actually that happens and the mother and baby go through the stress actually releases those hormones, which are extremely important for such a transition to happen. So in transient tachypnea of newborn, there is inadequate sodium transport, either because of decreased number of transporters or because of lack of activation. So the key messages from this first case is, how did we know at 2 hours? Could we have identified early whether this was normal or abnormal? So grunting after birth is normal, little bit of distress is normal. But if a baby needs oxygen, then it becomes abnormal transition. So needing oxygen essentially is, you know, a key sign that your baby is not probably heading towards a normal transition. Then the next question is, what else could that nurse or the doctor have done? So again, close monitoring every 10 minutes, 15 minutes to see, because if it is a normal transition, every hour it should improve with time. This case, we saw that every hour, every few hours, it was actually increasing. The distress was increasing, problems were increasing. If anything is abnormal, then it is a good idea to find some extra information. So getting the chest x-rays, like in this case, the gas helped us make the decision that, okay, we should admit the baby, start the baby on CPAP. So such things would help if we can do it early. And if, and again, in this case, especially because there was grunting and oxygen requirements, giving the baby some PEEP, which is CPAP, would have been preferable to giving low flow oxygen. There should be minimal role of low flow oxygen in the newborn ICU, basically, because knowing the physiology, the lungs need to be expanded. It will help better if the baby is distressed, especially if there is transient tachypnea or some component of RDS. So let us go to our next case. This case is baby M. This is again a late preterm, 35 plus 3 weeks, 2.3 kilo. This mother had a PV leaking for 2 days. LSES was done for decreased fetal movement. This baby did not cry after birth and needed positive pressure ventilation for around 1 minute. But after 1 minute, the baby cried and, you know, color improved. So did not need any extensive resuscitation. ABGA scores were also reasonable, 5 and 7. At 30 minutes, again, the mother noticed that the baby was a little cold. Peripheries were dusky. There was minimal distress, but saturations were 92 to 94 only on room air. So it was thought that probably the baby is having some cold stress. They rewarmed the baby. The baby seemed a little better after that. At 2 hours, the baby took 1 Palada feed. There was some occasional grunt again, but the peripheries continued to be dusky. Capillary refill was around 3 to 4 seconds and saturations were 90% on room air. However, when the baby cried, the baby would turn a little more blue, 80 to 85% on crying. Again, the next question is this normal? We'll go through the same questions for every case. Is this normal transition or does something seem abnormal here? Again, when to intervene? Should we just wait for some more time? You know, you don't want to separate the mother and baby. Should we try skin to skin? What intervention should happen? Should we just do some lab testing, check for infections? And again, how can we prevent a worst case scenario in this case? So let us see what happened in the clinical course of this baby's life. So at 6 hours, again, this baby was having increasing distress. Peripheries were a little more dusky. Saturations were 85% despite being on 2 liters of oxygen by nasal prong. So essentially the baby was on 100% oxygen and yet the saturations were only 85%. During crying and handling, the baby would turn even more blue. The blood gas showed acidosis. This time it was sort of a mixed acidosis. So the pH was 7.12, PCO2 was 62. Bicarbonate of 15 and base excess of minus 11. And again, an X-ray was done. So this is the X-ray. Again, low volume lungs. You can see air bronchograms on both sides. And the cardiac shadows are not very, very clear. So again, because of the grunting and the desaturations, the baby was, you know, getting sicker. So they decided to intubate the baby, ventilate, give a dose of surfactant. But still the baby needed around 80% oxygen to maintain saturations above 90%. So the baby's oxygen requirement seemed very much out of proportion to the condition. Antibiotics were started because the mother had PV leak for 2 days and IV fluids were initiated. And then a 2D echo was done. So going through this 2D echo, I think. Okay. So let us talk about what echo findings are there. So basically there was right to left shunt from the PFO. There was right to left shunt from the PDA. So pulmonary artery to aorta. The septum seemed indented towards the left ventricle. So the right ventricle was enlarged. and the septum was sort of pushed towards the left ventricle. There was tricuspid regurgitation. Right ventricle, left ventricle function at that point was maintained and normal. So these findings are very classical of PPHN or persistent pulmonary hypertension of the newborn. This was transitional again because of delayed transition. The baby sort of went into PPHN because the RDS component was not picked up and treated early. So again, we'll go through a little bit of physiology. We will talk a little bit about what happens in neonatal transition in terms of circulation. So the main thing is that inside the womb, placenta does all the gas exchange. So the baby's lungs are essentially not getting, you know, just getting 10% of the blood supply because there is no purpose of the lungs inside the womb. The oxygenation is happening because of the placenta and the mother's blood. So the main change is that there is transfer of gas exchange from the placenta to the lungs. Pulmonary vascular resistance, as the lungs expand, oxygenation improves. The placental circulation is eliminated. So, and placenta is actually a very low resistance circuit. So as soon as you eliminate that, there is increase in systemic vascular resistance. As the lung expands, there is a drop in the pulmonary vascular resistance. So these are broadly the changes happening. So when you encounter a hypoxic neonate, we will go through four scenarios. And again, I'll be a little slow on this slide and I want everybody to sort of focus on these pictures. So let us look at this left-hand bottom scenario where my cursor is. So let us see what is happening in this scenario. You can see that from the PFO, there is left to right shunting. The other blood from the left atrium is going down. From the PDA, again, there is left to right shunting. So if this baby is hypoxic, like you are, this is what the echo is showing, and the baby is not maintaining oxygen saturations, what will be your primary diagnosis? The shunts are left to right, which is what we expect. So this is a normal parenchymal lung disease without any component of cardiac disease and without severe amount of pulmonary hypertension. So this sort of is what we see in babies with RDS, with babies with pneumonia, babies with meconium without severe PPHN. The shunt direction is maintained left to right. And broadly, you know, there is good outflow from the aorta and the RV. So this is the first scenario. Now we move up to this second scenario on the left-hand side on the top corner. So let us see what is happening here. On the PFO, there is right to left shunting, which is not normal. On the PDA, there is left to right shunting, which is what we expect from the PDA, left to right shunt. But if you look at the RV is again a little dilated. The septum is sort of bulged into the LV. So this is similar to what we saw in PPHN, except that this shunt seems to be in the opposite direction. The PDA shunt seems to be in the normal direction. So the problem is not with the pulmonary vessels here. The problem is actually with the RV outlet. So this is actually a scenario which is called as duct dependent pulmonary circulation. So this, the cases or, you know, the etiology which will have these kind of picture will be a critical PS, which is a critical pulmonary stenosis, or a tricuspid atresia or a pulmonary atresia. So in this case, you would actually want the duct to be open because your duct is the only way that your lungs are being supplied. So this is a duct dependent pulmonary circulation. So that is a second scenario. Now let us look at this right side on the top side, top corner. So here you can see that the PFO shunt is on the right to left, PDA shunt is on the right to left. So both are in the opposite direction and you can see a TR. So this is exactly what we saw in the previous echo. So that is a PPHN case. So management we'll talk about later, but this is sort of a echo in PPHN. Let us come down to this fourth box, which is the bottom right. What is happening here? On the PFO, you can see that the shunt is happening from the left to right, which is in the normal direction. But in the PDA, it is happening from right to left, which is opposite. Also, you can see that there is some LV dysfunction. And the septum, as you can see, is actually bulging into the RV. So again, what can cause this? This is the opposite of this. So this is duct-dependent systemic circulation. So if there is any obstruction on this side, which is the aortic outlet or the LV outlet, it will cause this picture. There will be there will be MR, where the flow will be going from the LV to LA and LA will be going to RA. So left to right shunt on this side, but the PDA will actually be from right to left and that will supply the systemic circulation. So, and rarely in cases where the PPHN progresses to a very severe degree, it can also give us a picture like this. So PPHN with LV dysfunction can also have this picture, but typically this is a ductus dependent systemic circulation. So again, you actually need to give prostaglandin to keep your duct open, because that is the only way your organs will be perfused. So coming to the etiology of PPHN, the classic type of PPHN, or you know, the uncommon type of PPHN, is actually idiopathic PPHN or the black lung PPHN, where actually the problem is with the pulmonary vasculature. This type of PPHN is actually very rare and very uncommon. It is due to the idiopathic, remodeling of the pulmonary vessels. So the pulmonary artery, which has a tunica media, intimalis, so the tunica media actually gets remodeled and thickened. This type of PPHN is also extremely hard to treat. It won't be responsive to nitric oxide. It won't be responsive to pulmonary vasodilators. The next type of PPHN is due to parenchymal diseases. So here the primary problem is in the lung, like MAS, severe sepsis, severe RDS, and the pulmonary vessel simply constricts due to that. So there is abnormal constriction of the pulmonary vasculature. This is actually one of the most common causes of PPHN. The third type is abnormal transition at birth. So this is similar to the case that we saw. There was RDS, TTN, and then our baby sort of went into pulmonary hypertension because it wasn't treated in time. So there is impaired pulmonary vasodilatation, again seen in TTN and asphyxia. So this second and third type of PPHN that are there are sometimes together also called as maladaptive PPHN, which means there is maladaptation of the pulmonary vasculature and constriction of the pulmonary vasculature. The last type of PPHN is hypoplastic PPHN, where there is a problem with the development of the lung, so seen in CDH or pulmonary hypoplasia. So these are the commonest causes, meconium aspiration being the most common, RDS, pneumonia, sepsis, asphyxia, and lung hypoplasia being the other causes. So this flowchart is actually oversimplified. It is, PPHN is never an easy thing to diagnose, but if at all there is anything we can simplify, this is a really good slide. So let's go through this. So if you have a baby with suspected PPHN, you suspect PPHN when the oxygen requirement is out of proportion to the baby's distress. There could be difference in the upper limb and the lower limb saturation. So the right upper limb is our preductal saturation. All other three limbs are normally postductal. So there will be a difference of at least 5 to 10% saturations between the right upper limb and the lower limb. The baby will be extremely labile on handling. You touch the baby cries and the saturations drop from like 95 to 80. The baby turns a little blue and then it takes a while to pick up. So that extreme lability to handling, to pain, is very typical of PPHN. And then obviously in the current era, echo is very easily available. So 2D echo will show you all the findings that we went through to confirm the diagnosis. So again, you do a 2D echo, diagnose PPHN, rule out other structural anomalies, check your BP, pH and everything. First thing in PPHN again is adequate lung recruitment. So because, like I said, the most common cause of PPHN is maladaptation. So there will be an underlying lung disease, most commonly MAS, but could be severe RDS or sepsis or pneumonia. So recruit the lung, make sure that the lung is recruited, and then check your circulation. So if the blood pressure is normal and the cardiac function is good, so means your heart is taken care of, then you can simply start nitric. Nitric oxide is selective. It is a pulmonary selective vasodilator, very effective. It doesn't have systemic side effects. If it is not available, then sildenafil can be tried. But the only problem is that sildenafil is given IV or oral. So it has systemic action also. So it can cause a little bit of hypotension also. Second scenario is that your BP is normal, but the cardiac function is not very good. So then this scenario, you need to first support the heart before you start nitric oxide. So something like milrinone or dobutamine, one of the two will help. They both are reasonably good inotropes. Milrinone has an additional pulmonary vasodilator effect. So milrinone is probably preferred. Inotropy-wise, dobutamine is a stronger inotrope. So that is your second scenario. Third scenario, which again we commonly see, is that your BP numbers might be low, but the echocardiologist says that the heart function is okay. So then you have to give something that raises the BP. So giving a fluid bolus. Again, inotrope, there is a lot of controversy what to start. Currently, probably epinephrine is considered superior to dopamine for this sort of situation because it is an inotrope, but it doesn't cause, increase the oxygen requirement of the heart. If your hypotension is resistant to inotropes, then hydrocortisone will help. Hydrocortisone is also, doesn't cause any, increase in pulmonary vascular resistance. If there is low blood pressure and cardiac dysfunction, then you should be very worried, because that is the sickest PPHN. If the PPHN baby is also in shock and has cardiac dysfunction, so again, this baby needs inotropes first to lift your BP. Again, most of the medicines that will raise your BP will be vasoconstricting. So vasoconstriction means that will add more strain to the heart. So you'll also have to support the heart with a good inotrope. So you will need inotropy plus vasoconstriction. So like I said, PPHN is probably one of the most difficult cases to manage. But this slide sort of simplifies it or oversimplifies it and lets you, you know, go through a few scenarios. So always make sure first that the heart is well supported, number one. Number two, that your BP, because the PPHN is a balance between your systemic pressure and your pulmonary pressure. Depending on which pressure is higher, the shunt will be either right to left or left to right. So make sure that your BP is, you know, at least appropriate for the gestation age. If the baby is looking underfilled, dehydrated, then a fluid bolus usually doesn't harm. It is usually always helpful in such a scenario. If the choice of inotrope is there, again, think about the cardiac function. If the cardiac function is good, then giving a little bit of systemic vasoconstrictor like adrenaline might be okay. But if the function is poor, then probably first give it with a pure inotrope like a milrinone or dobutamine, and then add the systemic vasoconstrictor. And nitric oxide is selective. So if available, you know, most cases nitric oxide works wonders in PPHN. So what are the key messages again in terms of transition in regarding this case number two? Oxygen needs were higher than distress. So that, you know, gives us a clue. That baby was always saturating 85, 90, desaturating while crying. So that was one clue. Very labile when crying and handling. Pre and post ductal difference, which should have been checked and could have been checked. And supportive management is extremely important. So what we didn't talk about in the last 2-3 slides is how else to keep the pulmonary vessels happy. So avoiding pain. So sedation is usually needed for babies who have pulmonary hypertension. Maintaining temperature, maintaining glucose, maintaining a good pH and carbon dioxide. So all these things are extremely important in managing PPHN. Because if you just give nitric oxide, but the baby is acidotic, or, you know, constantly the baby is being handled, there is a lot of noise, light, then, you know, the PPHN will keep increasing because the pulmonary vessels are extremely sensitive and very reactive to all these stimuli. Coming to the third case, this is a baby O. Again, a late preterm baby, 36 plus 5 weeks. Mother had gestational diabetes on insulin. The baby was delivered by LSCS. Due to polyhydramnios and preterm labor. It was a good sized baby, 3.2 kilos, and the baby cried immediately after stimulation. Apgar scores were 7 and 10. At 30 minutes, the baby had some grunt on crying, but otherwise was very pink. Saturations were 97% on room air and pink. At 1 hour, they did a sugar because the mother had GDM on insulin, and it was 19 mg per DL. So the doctor came and saw that the baby was otherwise asymptomatic. So decided to give a feed because the baby was having some grunt. Rise tube feeding was given because the baby was not taking the volume orally. So 20 ml feeds were given. At 2 hours, a repeat sugar was done, which was 24. So again, they saw that the sugar is low, but at least they saw a rising trend. So the doctor felt, okay, from 19, it has become 24 and it was feeding. So probably it won't rise quickly. And let me check after 4 hours. So again, after 4 hours, another RT feed was given, which was 20 ml. So the baby took that and there were no obvious symptoms. The baby was sleepy after feeds, but overall doing well. So again, let us go back to our question scenario. So is this normal or abnormal? Because we all know that, you know, sugar levels sort of drop and at 2 hours, there is a nadir of sugar. So that is one thing that we already know. So is this normal or abnormal? When to intervene? So should we check sugars at 1 hour, 2 hours, or can we wait for later? And, you know, third thing is what to intervene. So we found the sugar. Was giving oral feeds better? Should we give RT feeds like we did? Could some sugar have been given like a dextrose or a dextrose gel? Or should we have started IV fluids? So that is the next question. And then again, how do we anticipate and plan for the worst case scenario? So that is the fourth question. So the same four questions will sort of help us stepwise plan the interventions. So let's see what happened to this baby. So at 6 hours, they noticed that the baby is now dull, jittery, and the repeat sugar actually had dropped to 12 mg per DL. So that was a little bit of a surprise. The doctors thought that, you know, it is actually showing a rising trend. Plus they have given two feeds. by RT. So, you know, from their perspective, they felt that they have taken due care. But unfortunately, the baby's sugars were only 12. IV insertion at that time became very difficult. So they gave RT feeds and there was a lot of panic. They called the senior doctors. And then finally an IV was secured. And by 12 hours, the sugars, you know, continued to be low. It showed a very slow increase. And at 12 hours, the baby was needing 15% dextrose and a very high GIR to maintain the glucose. So the glucose is finally came under control by around 8 to 10 hours of life. But the baby was obviously needing a very high GIR. This is an MRI picture of the baby later on. So the baby actually went on to have some seizures. This picture is a diffusion weighted image. You can see that the occipital area is lit up or bright. So there is some amount of hypoglycemic brain injury that the baby has suffered. So with this sort of history, we will now delve again into the metabolic and endocrine part of the transition, which is often neglected. When we think about transition, you know, the lung and the circulation comes to our mind first. But I think this is something that is equally important. So what happens to the babies, you know, in the fetus as they grow is that near term, glucose and other substrates start getting stored and deposited as glycogen and fat. So this happens late. It happens in the third trimester and it keeps increasing by 32, 34, 36 weeks. So if a baby is born before that, these stores will be very minimal. So, you know, the baby has less resources if the baby is premature or IUGR. Increase in cortisol and catecholamines are again major acute regulators of plasma glucose. So again, that natural labor and the stress that the baby has and the mother has during the process of labor and delivery is extremely important. Normally, insulin levels should fall as the glucose levels drop because insulin is a hormone that sort of drives the glucose intracellularly. So if the glucose is low, then the body should automatically reduce the insulin secretion. So what happens is, when the baby's umbilical cord is clamped, so inside the uterus, the baby is getting a constant supply of glucose from the mother. The baby's glucose is roughly 2/3 of the mother's glucose value. So if the mother's glucose is 100, the baby's glucose value will be roughly around 75. So umbilical cord clamp, as soon as it's clamped, suddenly there is, you know, the stop of constant glucose flow. Obviously, right after the baby is born, nobody is going to feed the baby. Normally, you know, wrapping, warming, transition sort of takes 1 hour, half an hour. So till that time, there is absolutely no supply of glucose to the baby and baby's production is not induced right away. So, you know, that leads to this natural nadir. The lowest glucose is sort of thought to occur at 2 hours of life. There are two types of hypoglycemia that we need to know. One is a fasting type of hypoglycemia, which is, you know, usually milder. It happens by the time there is 1.5, 2 hours, 2.5 hours gap from the previous feed. And after the feed, it quickly improves. The second type of hypoglycemia is due to hyperinsulinism, where the insulin levels are high abnormally, despite the glucose being low. So no matter what glucose we give, it is just driven intracellularly. If we give a feed, the body tries to build up a little bit of sugar, but it's driven intracellularly. And the babies usually have a very, very high glucose requirement. So this is the hypoglycemia, which is usually resistant, needs a higher glucose infusion rates, and usually also the one that causes problems and neurological injury. So talking a little bit more about the endocrine part. So cortisol, you know, is, we all love steroids. We are giving postnatal steroids, antenatal steroids. So is there any ground research to it? And, you know, what is the physiology behind it? And why do we have to give it? So nature has already created what is called as a cortisol surge for all babies who undergo natural delivery. So switch from maternal derived corticosteroids to the fetal adrenals happens later during pregnancy. So the fetus adrenal glands sort of keep maturing. And, you know, by the time the baby is in the late second trimester and third trimester, the fetal cortisol sort of starts getting secreted. However, till 30 weeks, that cortisol levels are quite low. The cortisol levels progressively increase to around 20 mg per ml by 36 weeks. So once the baby is reaching, you know, towards the late preterm period, the cortisol levels are at a decent level. But even with that, during natural labor and all, it sort of surges to 45. And around labor and all, it peaks to as high as 200 mg per ml. So you can see that if a baby is delivered at 36 weeks, the normal cortisol that the secretion is 20 mg per ml, and 10 times steroids are, you know, created by this process of natural labor. So that is how important the labor is, that, you know, it creates a natural cortisol surge. So what does this cortisol do? So you know, cortisol, we read that it increases till 36 weeks and peaks in labor. It is important for lung maturation, for surfactant maturation and production. It clears the fetal lung fluid. If we go back to our first case scenario, we saw how cortisol actually activates the epithelial sodium channels and makes that lung or the type 2 pneumocyte absorptive, you know, which was previously secreting fluid. It actually makes it absorb the fluid. It causes functional maturation of the gut. It regulates catecholamines release. So the endogenous catecholamines like epinephrine and norepinephrine, that release is also regulated. And it also controls the energy substrate metabolism. So it helps in these transition, you know, to maintain the glucose by regulating gluconeogenesis and glycogen breakdown. So whatever, you know, the body was getting ready for delivery, storing glycogen in this 1-2 hours, you know, when the baby is fasted, cortisol will help in utilization of these resources to produce glucose. So even when the baby is fasting or, you know, there is some delay in feeding, most cases, again, the sugar levels are maintained very normally. So this picture actually tells you how, you know, cortisol sort of helps in maintaining the blood pressure. So normally after birth, there is something called as transitional hypotension. During transition, the blood pressure sort of fall. And, you know, in the first half an hour, 2 hours, 3 hours, the BP sort of falls. And by 24, 48 hours, it slowly settles. So the squares are showing that the drop in blood pressure, the normal drop in blood pressure is much lesser in babies who received antenatal corticosteroids. So it stabilizes the blood pressure, which is extremely important because hypotension is a big problem in, you know, term and preterm babies, much more in preterm babies. And we already know that the more inotropes we use and, you know, the more shock the baby has, it is going to lead to more IVH and abnormal neurodevelopmental outcomes. So giving antenatal steroids stabilizes the BP. So these again are all animal experiments. This is again a lamb experiment picture, very old picture, but very well quoted. So this, the first part is showing effects of steroids. So what is happening is that this on the y-axis is the lung volumes at 40 centimeters of water pressure. So these lambs were bagged with this much pressure. And the control lung, which was, there was no steroid, only had a volume of 10 ml with the 40 pressure. But if there was steroid effect was given, there was much higher volume generated. And steroids plus surfactant, there was even higher volumes. So basically, antenatal steroids and surfactant, they help in improving the volumes in this lung model. So again, lung circulation are probably the two most important organs. And again, cortisol, whether it is endogenous or if not, then at least antenatal steroids given go along a big way in improving outcomes because of these two mechanisms. So how could we have prevented this case? Again, coming back to the case. So the initial sugar check is usually done at 2 hours, but that is provided if the baby is well. Obviously, if the baby is coming to the NICU, the baby is sick, baby is having some other symptom, you are, you know, more than allowed to check a sugar early. Any value less than 25 should, you know, give you a higher index of suspicion. So the first sugar of the baby was 19, which was very low. We see a lot of sugars which are low, but most of them are between 25 to 45. So they will be 30, 35, you know, so you know that you should be a little bit more alert if the sugar value first one is less than 25, especially less than 20. And it's always a good idea to confirm it with the lab value. Always keep in your mind that there are two broad etiologies of hypoglycemia, the fasting type and the hyperinsulinemic type. The fasting types are much more common. They improve very much with feeds and they will drop, you know, pre-feed, you'll find that they are low and they will usually be between 30 to 40, 45. They won't be extremely low, but the hyperinsulinemic babies will have a very low sugar and they won't be responsive to the glucose easily. And the important thing again is why are we so focused on glucose is because that is the only fuel for the brain. So the brain can't use any other source of fuel except for glucose. So that is why, you know, maintaining sugars above a particular level becomes extremely important because not only does it cause long-term problems, but also it is preventable. So whenever we talk about preventable problems, as doctors, again, we are liable. Not only ethically, but also medico-legally, if we miss, you know, screening for hypoglycemia when it was indicated or treating it in the right time, you know, because once the baby has a neurological injury, it is usually irreversible. So let us go to our last case. This baby is again, baby A. So this is our fourth case and the last case. 35 plus 5 weeks, 2.5, 2.9 kilos, so good size baby. The mother had actually a large PV bleed and there was cord prolapse. So cord prolapse again is a emergency because, you know, the baby can get compromised at any time. There was fetal bradycardia and emergency C-section was done. The baby did not cry after birth and had to receive IPPV. And this baby needed IPPV actually for a good 3 to 5 minutes. The heart rate was, you know, between 60 to 80. So chest compressions were not needed, but the baby's color, tone, and that all took some while to pick up. So the 1 minute Apgar was only 3 and the 5 minute Apgar was 8. So at 30 minutes, again, the mother complained that the baby is not, you know, looking very active. The breathing looked okay. The baby was quite calm. In fact, looking a bit dull. And then the saturations were 95% on room air. So at 2 hours, the nurse gave a feed because the baby was not sucking at the breast. So he took one Palata feed. The baby looked slightly pale, but the SpO2s were again stable and the sugars were 45. So for 2 hours for a baby with GDM, the 45 sugar is sort of borderline, not very critical. So again, the doctor, the pediatrician on call was called, and then there was the same thoughts running through their mind. This baby is 2 hours, you know, it could be normal. Should we give some time to this baby? If yes, then when should I intervene? Or, you know, what other signs should I look for? This baby looks like he's, you know, slowly going to improve probably. If I want to intervene, what should I intervene with? This baby is, you know, neither having very low sugar that I can start an IV. Saturations are okay, that the baby doesn't need oxygen. So what intervention am I going to do for this baby? And again, what could be the worst case scenario for this baby? So coming again to this baby's case. So at 12 hours, the baby had abnormal movements, tonic movements, seizure, which seemed seizure-like. The feeding had remained poor, but with Palata feeding, the nurse was, you know, able to pour some milk and the baby was sort of swallowing. But with the seizures, the baby's color had sort of become very off and pale, and the sugars were again persistently borderline. They were between 35 to 45. Again, 18 hours, the baby had to be ventilated. IV fluids were started, inotropes and antibiotics were initiated. And again, the MRI was done on day 6. So this baby sort of ended up having some HIE, hypoxic ischemic brain injury. You can see that the basal ganglia region, the globus pallidus and all, is brightly inflated. So there has been some deep gray matter injury on this baby's MRI, which is classical of HIE. So what happens with pathological events after an HIE? So HIE occurs, then there is a short acute time where there is primary necrosis, cellular death happening here. Then there is a latent phase for, you know, around 6 hours. And then there is something called delayed neuronal death, apoptosis, and that, which, you know, goes on for many hours to days. So basically during this latent period, we have a window where we can cool the baby by giving therapeutic hypothermia, which has now become the standard of care for moderate to severe HIE cases. So how is it done? So once we, you know, identify the baby, that this baby qualifies for therapeutic hypothermia, we can enroll the baby and start cooling. Cooling is usually done quickly. So it is done within 30 minutes to 1 hour. So baby's temperature from 37 is brought to our target range. Our target range for cooling is between 33 to 34 degrees. And then once that is there, we maintain the baby in that temperature for a period of 72 hours. Once 72 hours are done, then we have what is called as slow rewarming. So that is a slow phase where we slowly rewarm the baby at, you know, less than 0.5 degrees centigrade per hour. So over the next 6 hours, the baby will slowly be rewarmed to back to the normal temperature. So this cooling therapy is sort of known to improve the long-term outcomes in babies with moderate to severe HIE. But before that, you know, there is another question, that how do you classify HIE? So we have, you know, scorings like Sarnat and Sarnat scoring, Thompson scoring. So doing that, you know, detailed neurological examination is very much necessary, because otherwise it's very easy to miss a dull baby. You know, it can be easily labeled that this baby is a little dull, a little pale. But if you objectively score it, and if the baby truly fits in that moderate to severe criteria, that means, you know, we should be a little more alert. We also need to confirm and reiterate our findings by checking a blood gas. So either a cord gas or a neonatal gas, preferably sent within the first 60 minutes of life, which shows significant metabolic acidosis, which means a pH of less than 7 or 7.1 with a base deficit of more than minus 14. So base excess of more than minus 14. So metabolic acidosis should be there along with encephalopathy, and plus, you know, a surrogate or a corroboratory finding will be a risk factor. So risk factor in this case was called prolapse. Some cases it is need for resuscitation, chest compression. Sometimes it is a massive, you know, antepartum bleeding. So once we have the setup for HI, second thing is the gas, and third thing is actually presence of encephalopathy. So if these three things are present, or even two are present, then, you know, we should always consider a lower threshold for cooling the baby. So what does this cooling do, or therapeutic hypothermia do? So it reduces the brain metabolism, prevents further cerebral edema, decreases the energy utilization, reduces the cytotoxic amino acid accumulation, and suppresses free radical activity and inhibits the apoptosis. So if started in that timely window of 6 hours, it can help reduce a lot of further brain injury. This first picture on top is the tichotherm, or the whole body cooling equipment. The second picture on the down is the cool cap. So this is selective head cooling. So in trials, both have been used. Some studies have used the selecting head cooling. Most studies have used the whole body cooling. This is much more widely available currently, the whole body cooling. There is a Mira Cradle, which is the Indian version. There is tichotherm, which is available in the West. So is cooling standard of care? What is the evidence for cooling? There have been more than 25 randomized trials with over 3,000 enrolled babies, and it has shown that in term and late preterm babies with moderate to severe HI, cooling therapeutic hypothermia or cooling improves survival without neurodevelopmental impairment. And selective head cooling and whole body cooling are equal in terms of efficacy, so either can be chosen based on the availability and feasibility. So again, thinking of this fourth case, how could we have prevented or been a bit more careful in this case? Again, you know, at 2 hours, it is very much possible that you are not able to assess whether it is normal or abnormal transition. But leaving that baby unattended probably is not the best idea. So then, you know, we'll go again and re-examine, do neurological exam at periodic intervals. That is one important message. Again, if there is a history of resuscitation, plus some, you know, background history of cord prolapse, plus the baby is looking dull, it is always again better to check a blood gas for metabolic acidosis, again a cord gas or a baby gas. And again, if the pH is 6.97 with severe metabolic acidosis, then you know right away that this baby needs admission. Then we wouldn't wait for 6, 8 hours, 12 hours, you know, for the baby to crash. If there is lactic acidosis, severe metabolic acidosis, then the baby would need admission right away. Cooling has become the standard of care. So again, if you work at a peripheral center which doesn't have cooling, there will be a medico-legal implication for early referral, because afterwards the family can read about it and, you know, come back and ask you that, why didn't you cool my baby? And in the Western world, again, this is a common cause of litigation. Again, the supportive management is extremely important. So we want to protect the brain. So again, other things that are important for the brain, sugar, maintaining sugars, maintaining blood pressure, hyperthermia, or, you know, increasing temperature is known with associated with adverse neurological outcomes. So we actually want hypothermia, but if hypothermia is not available, at least maintain euthermia, which is between 36.5 to 37 or 36 to 37. So excessive warming the baby is actually going to cause more harm. So again, in this case, you know, being more diligent could have probably prevented this. So the next few slides are just sort of, you know, combining and recapping the whole scenarios we met. So case one was a case of abnormal transition due to main problem being in the lung fluid clearance. Case two, the main problem was, again, there was a component of RDS, but the main problem was again with the pulmonary circulation maladapting, or PPHN. So there was a problem with pulmonary transition. Third case, we saw that the glucose regulation was abnormal. The mother was GDM and the insulin levels were high. They remained persistently low. Baby ended up getting seizures. And the fourth case was a case of perinatal depression, which again, there was some difficulty in transitions, but the baby suddenly had a seizure at 12 hours and caught everybody by surprise. So what is common between all these cases? When we see a problem with transition, majority of the cases, like I showed in the first slide, will have a normal transition. Then the next majority of the cases will have abnormal transition, which are very easy to identify and prevent. So these cases are usually not missed. The babies, you know, will declare themselves quite easily, quite early, and they will be treated appropriately. There is a proportion of babies, you know, like the exactly the four cases that we discussed, they all came in this category. So they were all problems with transition, but at 2 hours, even if you re-look at the slides, it is a little tricky to figure out when, you know, to say clearly that, oh, this is very sick or very abnormal. only later on in these cases we realize that the babies, you know, turned out to be actually disasters. So there is a small group, and that is the only role where, you know, we can improve, because the bottom two scenarios, like I said, we are already doing a good job. This chunk of babies, you know, where there is an easy chance of delaying the detection, easy to miss, is the group that we sort of need to catch them early. And there will be a small group which are still not preventable. These would be the rare metabolic disorders, you know, the duct dependent cyanotic or duct dependent systemic perfusions, which, you know, probably even after diagnosing, you can't do anything, sort of a thing. So there is a small group of non-preventable, you know, deaths as well. So our main focus of today's talk was to identify the babies which have a problem with transition, but which are very easy to miss. So one of the messages for today would be that think of transition as more than the lung. So far, you know, we are always focused on let the baby cry means, you know, things are okay. But crying and breathing is only one part of transition. So there are lung adaptations, but there are also cardiovascular adaptations, the closure of the shunts and, you know, the shunt flowing from fetal life, it is right to left, that becoming left to right, and the pulmonary pressures dropping, systemic pressures increasing, so that cardiovascular adaptation. Endocrine function, we talked a lot about the role of cortisol and how important it is and, you know, how undermined its role is. Metabolic adaptation, again, in terms of maintaining, regulating the metabolism and the glucose, other things, and thermogenesis, which is also extremely important. So how do we prevent it? Again, to summarize it, we should have a watchful eye. It will prevent, help you in the long run, you know, if you are very careful and watchful. The next question I often get asked is how frequently or how long should I monitor? So the simple answer is you monitor till you are happy with the transition. So if the baby is grunting at 2 hours, means you need to monitor again. If the grunting is lesser, but, you know, still there at 4 hours, means I'm not completely happy. So I'll actually again check the baby at 5 hours to see that, okay, now the grunt has completely gone. So similarly with the sugars, you know, if the sugar was first 19, then it becomes 25. Even if I'm not giving IV, then I'll recheck in half an hour, 1 hour to make sure it is now 40. So you should keep monitoring very closely till you are happy, because, you know, to say that, okay, the transition is normal, all the five items that we discussed previously should be complete. Lung transition, cardiovascular transition, metabolic, endocrine, and temperature, thermogenesis. So only if all these things are okay, then only you can go home saying that, okay, now the baby has transitioned well. Otherwise, the baby needs ongoing monitoring. Any resuscitation need means you should have a higher suspicion that a baby who's needed resuscitation is more likely to have hypoglycemia, is more likely to have PPHN, is more likely to have, you know, to be cold. So keeping an extra watch on babies with needing resuscitation is important. And not to forget the metabolic and the temperature issue. So if the baby is cold again, means, you know, it is also likely that the baby might have low sugar. So any part of this whole system, the natural system of transition is affected, it is very likely that other components of the transition may also be affected. So for those babies, we should, you know, be a little bit more watchful. So to conclude, sometimes, you know, for a baby as neonatologists, when we are attending a delivery, all we need is a good cry. Even, you know, we don't care about the reason. You know, that's what the obstetrician always tells us. Ki chalo, baby ne cry kar liya, matlab sab theek hai, and they just walk away. And then it is our job to make sure that all other transitions, like we discussed, also happen. So thanks everyone for attending. I'm open for questions. I've kept this talk a little short so we can have some meaningful discussion. And I'm happy to answer all the questions. Thank you. These are all the institutes I trained in, actually.
That's wonderful, Dr. Anish. I would just say that when we talk of transition, it often comes to everyone's mind that it is just about the breathing pattern of breathing and hypoxemia or SpO2s. But you have wonderfully explained by way of four scenarios that it is not only lungs, it is heart, it is brain, it is metabolism. So breathing, circulation, glucose, and CNS. So we have to take care of all the organs very carefully and have to prevent the things and anticipate the things and carefully, and frequent monitoring is the key. So there are a few questions in the chat box. So we would like to go one by one. So the first question is from the Dr. Kiran Goplani. She's asking that how long we can continue Milrinone in case of persistent pulmonary hypertension.
So that's a very good question. So basically, like I said, no, we would start milrinone for a baby who needs an inotrope support. So you have done an echo. Milrinone also causes a little bit of a reduction in your blood pressure because it's a vasodilator. So first thing we need to make sure is my BP okay? So if my BP is not okay, if my baby is hypotensive, then starting with milrinone is not a good idea because your BP is going to drop further. So then we should start with something like epinephrine. And once your BP picks up, then you start milrinone to mainly support the heart and also like a weak pulmonary vasodilator. And normally we continue till our baby has improved. So if my PPHN babies typically would be on 100% oxygen. So milrinone, once it starts and once the baby's blood pressure hasn't dropped, which is a side effect of milrinone, then it is usually well tolerated. So then we are not in a rush to stop it. We wait for the baby's PPHN to improve. So if it is meconium, usually it takes 3, 5 days, 7 days. If it is RDS, sometimes it recovers a little quicker. So once the baby's oxygen needs have come down to, you know, say 60% PPHN, the lability has decreased, at that point you can slowly start weaning milrinone. With nitric oxide, actually our use of milrinone has decreased quite a lot.
Okay. So next question is, what is the mechanism behind oxygen being a potent pulmonary vasodilator in transition physiology by Dr. Amit Suhail?
So there are two, that's a good question again. So there are two aspects to this. One of our thoughts, you know, that oxygen is helpful in terms of PPHN. We should maintain saturations between, you know, 94 to 100 if it is PPHN. That is again sort of gone away. So that is not the current thinking. So our saturation targets for a baby with PPHN also, just like our preterm babies, are actually 90 to 95 or, you know, maximum 97 currently. You don't want the babies to be hyperoxic. That is simply because when there is hyperoxia, the dissolved oxygen increases, which sort of leads to free radical production. And actually those free radicals are sort of waiting, you know, for NO to come. So when in animal studies, basically hyperoxia, you know, giving 100% oxygen, resuscitating with 100% oxygen has shown that your responsiveness to inhale nitric oxide actually decreases because the NO is actually inactivated by oxygen. So it forms a different compound. So babies who have high oxygen, who are on high oxygen, who got resuscitated with higher oxygen are actually going to be less responsive to nitric oxide. To a certain point, till you are, you know, oxygen is obviously important for all your tissues, metabolism, your aerobic metabolism should work. So oxygen should be given to maintain the saturations in a normal range. Hypoxia, acidosis, carbon dioxide, you know, low or high, PEEP being low or high, all these things are going to worsen your pulmonary pressure. So then they will actually make your pulmonary pressures worse. So providing, rather than I'm saying that, you know, providing high oxygen, I would say providing oxygen to maintain saturations between 90 to 95, maintaining a PaO2 between 50 to 80 helps reduce the pulmonary pressures.
Okay. So I would like to take most of the questions regarding pulmonary hypertension and PPHN. So Dr. Amit has asked one more question. YVP has to be normal for INO since it is a selective pulmonary vasodilator. In the algorithm, you showed that when the BP is normal and the cardiac function is normal, you would like to go for the inhaled nitric oxide as an option for the treatment. So he is asking the same.
Sorry, what was the question?
Actually, he wants to ask that why BP has to be normal for INO. Because
That is again a good question. Sorry. So basically, what happens is if your cardiac function is not normal, so if your heart is not going to pump blood, so if the problem is with the pump, so that has to be addressed first, because what your nitric oxide is going to do, it is only going to relax your pulmonary vessels. So two prerequisites almost for, you know, INO uses. One is that your lung should be inflated, because if your lung is not inflated, the INO won't reach the alveoli. So INO will only reach the alveoli which are expanded. And the second thing is that if there is cardiac dysfunction, pulmonary edema can actually worsen, because, you know, your heart is not pumping well and you dilate the blood vessels. So it will, you know, lead to more pulmonary edema and VQ mismatch. So taking care of the cardiac contractility function, you can start INO in the other scenarios, provided you take care of the cardiac function first. So one of the common reasons where we say that babies, you know, are not responding to nitric oxide, actually they might be responders. it could be because of one of the two reasons. One could be that we have not inflated the lung enough, so the nitric is not acting. And the second reason could be that the nitric is fine, but your heart is not pumping. So then nitric is not going to help with the pumping part of the heart. So that can actually exacerbate the pulmonary edema part. That is why nitric is actually not good to start right away. So many hospital protocols actually, you know, don't allow nitric unless you do an echo. But clinically, that is not always feasible here. So in our unit, we actually start with some inotrope empirically. And then once the echo is done, and then we start nitric. And by the time the cardiologist comes and does an echo, if he says that all the function is okay, then we tweak our inotropes and adjust it. Because then we are more confident that, okay, the function is okay. So then we, you know, adjust our inotropes. But we often in our practice also start inotrope simultaneously with nitric, just to take care of the function.
In continuation with the same, we had a comment from Dr. Ravi Khanna, sir, that despite sildenafil and milri non-infusion, pulmonary pressure takes time to fall to normal levels. He is asking how long the PPHN lasts in your experience.
So again, it depends on the etiology. We had a case of CDH last month where the PPHN lasted for 15 days because the CDH has two components of PPHN. One is a reversible component, one is the irreversible component due to hypoplasia. Meconium cases, usually it takes a good 2 weeks again, 2 to 3 weeks would be, you know, severe cases of meconium who have needed high frequency ventilation, who have needed, you know, 1 or 2 doses of surfactant. So if there is a severe type of meconium, maybe it is going to take, you know, 2-3 weeks for full recovery. The baby may not need nitric oxide for all 3 weeks, but so typically the course that we see with meconium aspiration is, you know, we start nitric oxide inotropes. By the end of 1 week, we are, you know, slowly coming down to 60-70% oxygen. By 10 to 14 days, we are, you know, on just basic ventilation, extubated by 14 days. Then the baby sometimes needs high flow or some sort of CPAP. And usually we are able to discharge them by 3 weeks only. So it differs with every etiology, depending on what the cause of PPHN is. Since meconium is the commonest cause, I gave that example. But usually it is a slow process because PPHN means, you know, the disease has already progressed beyond the lung. The pulmonary vessels have constricted and, you know, the vessels are sensitive. And if you wean too early, actually, there is a flip-flop mechanism where there can be a rebound pulmonary hypertension if you wean things too quickly. So it is always a good idea to go stepwise and slowly in terms of once you have established a diagnosis of PPHN.
Yeah, exactly. Often it rebounds in several cases. So we have a question from Dr. Ravi Khanna, sir, again, that what is the upper hour limit for the therapeutic hypothermia to start as we receive a baby's of hypoxic ischemic encephalopathy quite late?
That is a very common practical question, and it's been discussed not only in academic setups, but also in, you know, like hospitals, conferences, because if you are sitting in a tertiary center, you know, transport time, getting your team there, you know, sometimes there can be traffic again in Mumbai. So the reason the timeline is 6 hours is because trials have used it. The answer is as simple as that. All the RCTs sort of, you know, took 6 hours and they enrolled the babies in 6 hours. In practice, you know, if a baby comes to me at 8 hours, 9 hours, and if there is, you know, baby is fitting in the criteria, I would start therapeutic hypothermia in the current scenario because the evidence for that is overwhelming and very strong. I would speak to the family saying that, you know, the baby, this is typically a little later, but the benefits would still far outweigh the risks. Even in Canada, when I was there for 3 years, mostly we would start it by 8-9 hours, you know, if the baby would come late to us. Beyond 12 hours, I think probably there would be no role. Also because we don't know when the insult has happened. This 6 hour window is also assuming that the insult happened just around delivery. Sometimes we know that in asphyxia, the delivery, the insult can be antenatal, that is 1 hour prior to delivery or, you know, 30 minutes prior. So in that case, anyway, even if we start it at 4-5 hours, we might still be late. So that gray area is always there. But if 2-4 hours, you know, if it is late, then probably giving the benefit of doubt to the baby is completely justified.
Yeah, exactly. In fact, ours is the country where we face such kind of questions and we have to generate the data for the same. So more and more people should do that. By 9 or 10 hours, they should continue with the family taking in confidence and have a more follow-up so that we can have a better answer to this question, because West is doing it in a better way in our setup, because of the not good public-private coordination, we often face such kind of problems. So going to the next question from Dr. Amit, he is asking to enlighten about the transition physiology with regards to the renal adaptation and what is the difference in term and preterm.
Sorry, what adaptation?
We have talked of the various organs, lungs, heart, and now he is asking about the, is there any renal adaptation?
So that's again a good question. So there is, and the main reasons I sort of didn't include that is spine, because that would have been very long. So again, simply speaking, we know that, nature-wise, for a fetus to neonate, the fluid compartment sort of shifts. So a lot of fluid is extracellular and interstitial. So that fluid shift sort of happens and the baby loses the fluid in the first, few days of life. And the fluid shift happens initially, there is a 2/3, 1/3 ratio, and that sort of slowly changes. As that happens, by day 1, day 2, the renal circulation increases. The renin-angiotensin system sort of kicks in. That helps in also stabilizing the BP. That causes a little bit of diuresis. And with that increasing renal flow and diuresis, usually we say that, some problems like RDS actually reduce. So, again, for breastfed babies, it is a little different. In the NICU, actually, we have seen that, once we start the baby on IV fluids, the urine output is already quite high. But for babies who are breastfed, the natural milk output in the first few hours or first days, a few mLs of milk that the mother feeds to the baby. So that already is not sufficient enough to, increase the renal circulation, the efferent arterial constriction, increasing the filtration pressure and giving a good urine output. So renal maturation usually in a term baby takes probably 48 hours is the time of diuresis that we say. Again, in preterm babies, that is supposed to be delayed, but practically in the NICU, we don't see that. We see a good urine output, but in terms of renal maturation, we know that a premature kidney is neither able to concentrate urine very much nor able to dilute it beyond a certain point. So it can lose, it can act in a different way. The tubular immaturity can act either way. It can either throw out a little bit more sodium compared to water, or it can throw out a little bit more water compared to sodium. So it is basically an immature sort of a thing. And then it takes in preterm babies, because the GFR and the nephron load itself is low, it can take weeks to, reach the mature term function. But in healthy babies, usually 48, 72 hours, usually the diuresis happens.
So, we would like to have a question from the direct question from Dr. Niti Priya. She has raised a question and she would like to directly ask. So,
Dr. Niti Priya, you are unmuted. Kindly ask. Dr. Niti Priya, are you there? Please ask your question. I think she has some connectivity issue. Till she connects, we can take the other questions.
So going to the next question from Dr. Samarth. He is asking, how important is continuous pulse oximetry at the resuscitation table?
Sorry, what is continuous
pulse oximetry during neonatal resuscitation?
Continuous pulse oximetry or role of pulse oximetry?
Yeah, role of pulse oximetry.
So if you look at the NRP algorithm, if the baby does two indications for starting PPV, one is that if the infant is apneic or gasping, and one is if the heart rate less than 100, you start positive pressure ventilation. You go through your Mr. SOPA if things don't improve, that is mask, reposition, suction and all that. In the new latest NRP 2021, which is the latest update, so the pulse oximetry role sort of, you can put it as soon as possible practically, that is a practical answer. But when will you start using it meaningfully? That is a, question, that if the saturation comes 60, will you do something different versus the saturation coming 70? So for that, actually, you need to know a little bit about the normal saturation. So babies in utero, they are all, having low saturation. The saturation at birth will be 60 to 65. Every minute, you know, it will slowly improve by 5-5%, 5-5%. And only by 10 minutes is the saturation expected to reach 90. That is a normal thing. There are more than, you know, enough trials and solid evidence saying that resuscitating term babies with room air reduces the mortality and actually, you know, the time to first try is better. So there are enough meta-analysis on that. That for term babies, you can safely start with 21%. For preterm babies, you can start between 21 to 30%. So when would I use continuous pulse oximetry? I put it for all babies who are high risk. So we have a pulse oximeter, we put it in the right arm. And you notice that, you know, at the every minute, that is 2 minutes, 3 minutes, if the saturation is below the expected for that minute. So you should also have that chart of saturations minute wise up to 5 minutes and then at 10 minutes, which is 60, 65, like I said, 65, 70, 70, 75, 8, 75, 80, at, you know, 1, 2, 3, 4 minutes. So if it is less than that, so say if I'm at 5 minutes and my saturation is 75, then I know that I'm 5-10% less. So I'll improve, increase my FiO2. Again, NRP doesn't recommend how to increase, whether you should increase from 21 to 30%, 40%. So to increments of 10% or increments of 20%, again, it doesn't do. So for standardization, I think every unit can decide empirically. So, you know, if my heart rate is okay, and if my saturation is only a problem, then I'm not panicking much. Then I usually increase by 10, you know, like if I'm at 20, I'll do 30, 40, every 30, 30 seconds, I'll increase it. If my heart rate is not less than 60 or, you know, not audible or 60 to 100, then I'm a little more anxious. So I increase from 21 to straight away 50 and then 50 to 100. So then I do two increments. Again, this is not described in NRP. This is something that we do as a unit. And it was very similar practice in the Western units that I worked in, that they would sort of have like an empirical increment regime. So you can increase in. So that is when the role of saturation comes in, because basically for NRP, heart rate is the most important thing that you are always checking. Improvement in heart rate means things are okay. No improvement in heart rate means things are not okay. So saturation is important. It is good to know. It is good to have chest leads so your, you know, your heart rate measurements recording are accurate, but it doesn't add more than this to your resuscitation principle. It will help you guide how quickly you want to increase oxygen, and you know, you will, it will give you an additional indicator in terms of how to adjust it.
That's wonderful. Dr. Deepthi is asking, if baby has distress but maintaining saturation above 95%, what are chances of hypoxic ischemic encephalopathy?
So that is a good question again. So there is, that is difficult to answer without knowing the full scenario. So like I said, no, if there is no antenatal risk factor, again, the antenatal risk factors being, you know, something like a massive bleed, cord prolapse, decreased fetal movement, fetal bradycardia. So if there is nothing like that, if the baby didn't need resuscitation, and if the baby is grunting, then that is probably just normal transition. So then the chances would be negligible. But we should know that this baby probably, we should watch, because the so normal babies are allowed to grunt after birth, basically. They can grunt if the baby is saturating 99, you need not start anything for that baby. We don't start. We just watch the baby till the grunt goes away. But if at 1 hour, 2 hour, you know, the grunt is increasing, then you know that this baby probably has TTN. So to answer your question from HI point of view, I don't see any other reason for HI. If the baby just has a grunt and is maintaining saturation, there should be absolutely no risk for HI. But because the grunting is there and the transition is not right, I would watch the baby. If the grunt doesn't go away, then you should check a sugar, because that is the other component of transition that can affect the brain. And keep monitoring the baby till you are happy with the transition.
Okay. Another question is, how to manage PPHN, which is accompanying with the PDA?
So that is a common question. Again, we all burnt our fingers where, you know, we see a PDA, we close it quickly and then realize that there is, you know, PPHN worsening. So PDA in terms of PPHN can actually be a very helpful thing. Oh, sorry, there is some disturbance in the background. I think somebody is unmuted. Yeah. So PPHN, no, for the right ventricle. So the right ventricle outflow goes to the pulmonary, to the lungs, basically. So if the lung pressure is very high, the right ventricle can't pump blood into the lung. So then the PDA comes into play, and the PDA shunt is from right to left. So what happens if we close the PDA by then? By chance, if the PDA is closed, then the right ventricle has nowhere to pump. It can neither pump through the PDA, nor it can pump into the lung. So that causes right ventricular failure, which is actually a very critical thing to have in PPHN cases. So for a baby with PPHN, PDA is actually like a pop-off valve. It is helpful to have a PDA. Most cases of PPHN, the PDA will always be open because nature keeps it open, because that is the only way out for the right ventricle. So we should never be, you know, closing that by giving paracetamol or indomethacin. That is number one. In fact, many cases of PPHN where we find that the PDA is closing, we have to give prostaglandin to keep the duct open. So think of PDA as a harmless bystander in most cases of PPHN, which is actually the body's mechanism to, you know, make the right ventricle at least let out blood in some direction. So PDN, you know, we need to track it. Most of our babies with PPHN have a PDA of 3 millimeter, 4 millimeter by 1 week, 10 days. And once PPHN settles, you know, and after a week and all, it closes naturally. So we should never be in a rush to close a PDA in PPHN.
Yes, that is very correct that one should not close PDA when we are having PPHN, because that is only wind through which blood can overcome the resistance. So next, we would like to take the question regarding the sugar management. So Dr. Mathur is asking when to start GIR in case of hypoglycemia, and is there any role of fortified feeds with sugar in management of hypoglycemia?
When to start sugar monitoring?
He is asking when to start glucose infusion rate in case of hypoglycemia, and is there any role of fortified feeds with sugar, like adding sugar in the feeds to manage hypoglycemia?
So typically, if your sugars, like you say, no, like AAP guidelines are there, that typically if the sugar is between 25 to 40 in the first couple of hours of life, that could be taken as, you know, okay transition, and then you give feed and you recheck. If the sugars are below 25, if the baby is symptomatic, if the baby is, you know, having additional comorbidities like sepsis, if the baby is more preterm, severe IUGR, then there is probably no point in waiting, because the mechanism by which the baby is going to maintain the sugar is by glycogenolysis and gluconeogenesis. So if the baby doesn't have enough of stores because of either being premature or severe IUGR, or if the baby is sick because of sepsis or something, then there is no point in straining the baby's own system to, you know, maintain the sugar. So in that case, starting IV fluid a little earlier is more sensible. If the baby is like a LGA baby, which you did a sugar because of protocol, or a GDM baby because of protocol, that baby you can give a feed and wait. So in those cases, you don't start. Role of fortified feeds, again, there is data on dextrose gel. There are studies with dextrose gel where, you know, that dextrose, it's like basically like a dextrose solution that is given to the baby. There is role that can reduce. The risks again would be, you know, feed intolerance. If it's a preterm, then probable risk of NEC by giving that dextrose or fortified feed for that matter. The fortification that we typically add, HMF that we call, that per se wouldn't increase the GIR by much. So if it is like a borderline case, you know, 1 week old baby, which is preterm, where you would already think of fortification, you can add a little bit. Term babies also, practically we have done sometimes, you know, added in the West, they add polycal, which is a polycose, which is a carbohydrate fortifier, sometimes to the feeds. That can avoid IV, but beyond a point, it doesn't help. So for cases with where the sugars are borderline and the baby is asymptomatic, you can use a little bit of fortification and try and see if that works transiently. Sometimes you might have to use something like hydrocortisone or glucagon also in case of, you know, the sugars not responding, but beyond a point. So where should you worry in hypoglycemia? Like I said, if sugars are below 25 or below 20, number one. If the baby is symptomatic, number two, and if the sugars have been constantly low by 3 to 5 days, these three risk factors are associated with poor long-term outcomes. So if a baby has one odd low sugar, you know, and the rest have been okay, because parents often ask us that, you know, should I worry about long-term? Do you want to do MRI? So these three things are time-tested to be proven to be bad. Symptomatic hypoglycemia, that is seizures, dullness, any problem with the brain, then you must worry. Sugars below 20 have been associated with adverse outcomes, and persistent hypoglycemia beyond 3 to 5 days. So if any of these three are there, then you should take no chances. Then even target a sugar of 60, not even 45 for those babies.
Yeah, exactly. So continuing with the same discussion, Dr. Ravi Khanna sir has commented that in difficult cases can be used hydrocortisone, and I hope you have elaborated that in the discussion. So we are going to the next question, that is presence of in case of pneumonia with resolving PPHN physiology, are we justified to continue Meldrinone?
In cases of pneumonia with PPHN?
Yeah, as it, the PPHN can accompany pneumonia, RDS and MAS. So Dr. Kiran is asking, can we continue Meldrinone in case of resolving pneumonia?
Yes, so again, the answer is that these inotropes, so whether it is Meldrinone, vasopressin, norepinephrine, epinephrine, they all act based on the receptors. So Meldrinone, you can, there'll be two, one indication and one prerequisite. So the prerequisite for Meldrinone, like we discussed, is that your blood pressure is normal. So if your sepsis and pneumonia hasn't caused hypotension, then you can use Meldrinone. But the role of Meldrinone is better if you're actually having cardiac dysfunction, because it's an inotrope plus a vasodilator. So if there is some cardiac dysfunction with a normal BP, you can start Meldrinone. So etiology wise, sepsis pneumonia per se is not a contraindication to not start Meldrinone. We have used it in a lot of cases with PPHN secondary to sepsis.
Yeah. Then we have one basic question, how to differentiate PPHN from cyanotic heart disease?
So traditionally, or conventionally, we used to do the hyperoxia hyperventilation test. Currently, it is not practically done, but I can go through it quickly. So what happens is, you have a hypoxic neonate in front of you. You have measured the arterial gas and you have measured the SpO2. So the baby is hypoxic, so the arterial gas probably shows a low PaO2, 30-40. Saturations are whatever, 85, 80, whatever it is there. You give 100% oxygen. So that is the hyperoxia component of the test. So you have given 100% oxygen, give it for 10, 15 minutes, do a repeat gas. Your PaO2 goes above 150. Your SpO2 is now back to 95, 99. So things have improved. So that means that your cyanotic congenital heart disease is excluded. So there is no shunt in the heart. So then what it could be? It could be either a lung disease or it could be some sort of mild PPHN. So say that it doesn't improve, say that your PaO2 is still low. So that means you are either dealing with a heart problem or with PPHN. So then you move to the second component of the test, which is a hyperventilation test. So you hyperventilate the child again for around 10, 15 minutes. You keep rates of 60, 70. The idea behind hyperventilation, or the physiology behind hyperventilation, is that you want the CO2 to wash out, so that the pH becomes normal or slightly alkalotic. So you don't want any acidotic component. Again, what will improve when the pH improves? Only PPHN. The cyanotic heart disease won't improve. So after this hyperventilation maneuver, if your PaO2 improves or your SpO2 improves, then you know that it is most likely PPHN. Because in cyanotic heart disease, the problem, the shunting is happening inside the heart. So that is not going to improve with either of these two maneuvers. Remember that if it is severe PPHN, it won't improve with your hyperventilation. So it is not a black and white test. You know, there are some gray areas. Again, in the current scenario, it is difficult. We don't do it because most of our babies will be anyway on 100% oxygen. Again, practically, with other clues like the baby's lability, if it's a cyanotic heart disease, you'll never find a saturation above 95%. So, if it was documented 95% at some point, 97% at some point, then it dropped. If it's fluctuating labile, if it is those sort of things, then it is most likely PPHN. But again, the gold standard remains to be an echo. But we have not had, it is not very difficult to differentiate between the two. There will be an odd case where, there will be like a TAPVR, total anomalous pulmonary venous return, or something like that, which can be a bit confounding. But our usual cyanotic heart diseases, whether it is TGA, tricuspid regurgitation, those sort of diseases are usually easy to diagnose clinically.
Okay, then we have a question regarding how to manage right ventricular dysfunction and identify its possible causes.
So there is no easy answer for that. That is the most challenging cases of PPHN that you will be the ones with RV failure. It will appear like a PPHN baby, who's probably very sick. You should suspect right ventricular failure. Again, at that point, the important thing to check will be that, is my duct open? Because if your duct is not open, then you can do nothing for the right ventricular failure. You can improve the right ventricular contractility, but where will the blood go? The blood can neither go in your lung because there's severe PPHN, nor can it go in your PDA because your PDA is closed. So Again, the management remains a combination of cardio respiratory support. So you want to definitely support your failing right ventricle. So a good inotrope, which means like a dobutamine plus adrenaline, which is also a very good inotrope, is useful. Importantly is to again dilate your pulmonary pressures as soon as possible. So starting nitrix, you know, or sildenafil or some vasodilator at the same point will be very helpful. Like I said, thankfully by nature's, mechanism, PDA usually remains open. Like most of the times it will not close because PPHN is there. So nature knows that there is no way for the RV. So let me keep the duct open. Clinically per se, there is, not many clues by which we can say that this is right ventricular versus left ventricular failure. Finally, the baby presents with a sick baby with shock and hypoxia is what it will present with. So 2D echo usually plays a very important role. But if not, it is always better to err on the side of giving rather than not. So we always, like I said, before our cardiologist comes in, only we start an inotrope and we start. Adrenaline is usually a safer choice in these scenarios because it is also has some inotropy effect, and up to a dose of 0.2, it doesn't have too much of vasoconstriction, especially for the pulmonary vessels. So don't go on very high doses of adrenaline, but at least, 0.1 to 0.2 dose of adrenaline starting empirically usually is unlikely to cause harm in this situation. It will help the heart a little bit. It will increase your systemic BP, but it will not, stress out your pulmonary vasculature too much. So knowing about right-sided failure clinically is a little bit of a challenge. It usually happens later in the course of PPHN.
Okay. So we have a few more questions again. Dr. Neetu is asking your experience regarding servo-controlled therapeutic hypothermia machine versus Miracradle.
So the difference is mainly in terms of monitoring. In Miracradle, you have to be, here we do have the Miracradle. You have to be on top of things. You have to make sure that the fluctuations in temperature are a little more. In the Western world, they just have Ticotherm, which is like a automated servo controlled one. The temperature there, we used to see that it would change by 0.2, 0.3 degrees. Usually it would maintain, and that is what in trials has shown to be the best, that minimizing temperature fluctuations is probably the best way you can improve neurodevelopmental outcomes. Miracradle is very effective, no doubt, and much better than not having hypothermia. But here we notice that with that, the temperature sort of swings between 33 and 34 or, 32.8 to 34.2, something like that. So within that 1.5 degrees, which is the acceptable range, but it keeps, going up and down because it is not automated. It is manual. So by the time you, remove the cooler blanket, still for the next 1-2 hours, the temperature will keep dropping. Similarly, once, you start warming a little bit, before that thing acts, the temperature keeps moving in that same direction that it was taken. So that is the main difference that I have found. Again, there is no head-to-head study RCT which can say that, okay, this is much inferior, much superior. But physiologically, the temperature fluctuations, the less you have, the better it is.
Okay. Thank you, Dr. Anish. I think we have finished with the questions, and there were approximately 35 to 40 questions, and that was a very lucid talk. And I think everyone would agree that all of us face this kind of scenarios in our day-to-day practice. And without knowing basic physiology behind that, it is difficult to anticipate the long-term implications and fine-tuning of the management. That was really wonderful. I would like to invite Akash for the final words.
Thank you, Dr. Anish, for that excellent and lucid presentation. In fact, you have covered majority of the common scenarios, and what was not covered has been been brilliantly covered during question and answer session. Also, thanks to our moderator, Dr. Anita Singh, and for conducting this session brilliantly and answering all the questions and adding her experience wherever it was required. Before we end, Dr. Niti Priya, if you want to ask your question, you can unmute yourself and ask the question. Dr. Niti Priya, are you still there?
Yes, sir.
Please ask your question.
Nice. Actually, the talk was really nice. I don't have any questions at the moment, sir. Thank you so much.
That's wonderful.
thank you so much. And I think we all are hypoglycemic, and as we have rightly said, that we need to maintain euglycemia in order to both for short as well as long term good outcomes. So with that, kindly have your supper or dinner, whatever you require to maintain your blood sugar levels. Same is true for your babies also. Hypoglycemia, bilirubin injury, and hypothermia is something we should not occur in any NICU. With that, we see you next week with our how to do literature search and HFO ventilation, two very important topics. Till then, stay safe and be happy in whatever you do. Thank you, Dr. Anish, and thank you again, Dr. Anita Singh, ma'am. And it was really wonderful listening to you both.
Thanks. Okay. Thanks.